Again, I want to undergird this from the Bible. Verse 17 of John chapter 1, it says the law was given, how? How was the law given, verse 17? Through Moses. The law was given through a personality. The law didn't come directly from God. No, the law was given by God to angels, to Moses. And so Moses, he becomes the symbol of the law. He is a personality, a real person that lived. He represents God, and he represents the truth of God. So God gives his word, his truth, through the personality of Moses. Now, when you think about the Old Testament, now think about what the Bible actually says. When Jesus was telling the story about the rich man and Lazarus, and the rich man died, opened his eyes in hell, and Lazarus died and opened, found himself in the bosom of Abraham being comforted. And the rich man wanted Lazarus to go back and warn his brothers unless they end up in hell. What did Abraham say to the rich man? They have what? They have the law, and what else? The prophets. So Abraham says they have the law, which came through the personality of Moses. They have the prophets, who the word from the prophets that came through the personality of the prophets. If you know in the Bible, God always gives his word through a personality, through a human agent, a human personality. Even though the human personality may be frail, may be fragile, and may be fraud, God has chosen that his word would come through personalities. So you look at the canon of the Bible. We know is the canon, the 66 books of the Bible, the 39 in the old and the 27 in the new, 40 different authors, 40 different authors that lived over a span of 1,000 years, and many of them were not contemporaries, they did not know each other, and they didn't have the other person's material when they wrote their material. But when you read the materials, the style is different. They don't write the same. They had different experiences. They had different personalities. They lived in different times. And so it's different. But there appears to be an architect over the whole thing, bringing the whole thing together. And that's God. So the whole Bible that we have, it came through personalities. So the truth needs personality. So we need the local church in a community, in a neighborhood, so that people can encounter the truth, but so that they can encounter the truth through the personality of people who live in that neighborhood, live in that time, and live in that space. So that when people hear the truth, it's a truth they can relate to. Are you listening to me? It's a truth that they can relate to, a truth in the vernacular. It's in the word that they can understand and they can hear. And they hear it as if God is speaking directly to them, because that's the way God speaks. So churches should not be the same, and they should not try to be the same, because people have had different cultural experiences. They come from different backgrounds and different nuances, and they respond differently. They hear things differently. So you need churches with different styles, different cultures, and different nuances to appeal to the various people that are out there. Are you following me? We need the church because the truth needs a container, and the truth needs personalities through which to be transmitted, as the law needed Moses and as the word of God needed the prophets, so that their personalities came through and so that people could realize that the word of God is something that is practical. It speaks to me in a way that I can hear and I can understand. Well, I'm almost through. The third point that I want to bring to your attention about why we need the church is that the truth is to be pursued. It is to be pursued in the context of a group of people who have a common commitment to the truth. In John chapter 5, verse 39, I'm not going to turn there. You can read it. John verse 39, Jesus speaking to the religious leaders. He says, "You search the scriptures, because in them you think you have life. But they are those that testify of me." You see, oh, you ought to be searching the scripture, and you ought to be searching it together so that you might find life. But the scripture, if properly searched, it will always take you to the person of Christ. It will take you to the glory of Christ, the majesty and the splendor of Christ. The reason cults will often emerge is because you have one or two people who pull themselves off and they're going to find the truth that nobody else could find. And they come up with something that no one else has ever discovered before. But if you ever notice what they come up with, it does not exalt Christ. It does not point to the person of Christ. It points to either baptism, or it points to not eating meat, or it points to something else, but not the person of Jesus Christ. The truth needs to be pursued in the context of a fellowship. In John 8:32, Jesus is saying to his disciples, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples for real, and you shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free. So it's the pursuit of truth together, collectively. As iron sharpens iron, so does one man or one woman sharpen another man or another woman. The truth is to be pursued. Fourthly, as I hasten to close, in Jude chapter 6, a little old book just before the book of the Revelation, and we don't give much attention to it, but it's a powerful book because it speaks to what's happening in the end times, the defection, the falling away, how people fall away from the truth. Listen to what Jude, who was a half-brother of the Lord Jesus Christ, what he says to the believers of his day as he saw the defection of his day, Jude. He writes these words in verse 4. I will start in verse 4, or verse 5. But I want to remind you, though you once knew this, that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterwards destroyed those who did not believe. And the angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their habitation, he is reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of the great day. As Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them, in similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual morality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. So what Jude is talking about is, in case of the angels, they didn't keep their first estate. They didn't stay in their angelic realm. The truth they had about God, they didn't hold on to that truth. And Jude said, as a result of that, they will experience judgment, and some to this day are being held in chains until the final judgment. He then says, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them in a similar manner, having given themselves over to sexual morality. Sexual perversion and sexual immorality, it is the most powerful and it is the most profound example of people leaving the truth, of people departing from the truth, and they create a different standard of morality. They decided what God says is not true. And there's one thing to know what the truth is and decide not to live like it. It's another thing to say that that's not true. This is true. My father, by the grace of God, became saved before his death. And my father was not a man of great morality. But this is what my father said. He said to the people in my little community, I want y'all to understand, my mama was a godly woman. My father was a godly man. I know right from wrong. And my dad said, I want y'all to know, I don't live the way I live because I don't know better. I live the way I live because it's the way I choose to live. And there's no reflection on my mom and no reflection on my dad and no reflection on my upbringing. I choose to live like this. I know what's right and I know what's wrong. What's happening now in society today is we're trying to say the truth really isn't the truth. That what God has to say about morality is not true. But the morality we create is what is true. What we want to do is what's true. What makes us feel good is what's true, not what God said. And that's what they did in Sodom and Gomorrah. They decided that homosexuality is not wrong. So this is nothing new.